This week in Virology, the podcast about viruses, the kind that make you sick. This week in Virology, episode number 275, recorded on March 7th, 2014. Hey everybody, I'm Vincent Racaniello, and you are listening to TWiV, the podcast all about viruses. Today, I am coming to you from the campus of the National Institutes of Health in Bethesda, Maryland, and sitting next to me is Rich Condit.
Hi there, Vincent.
You're not in Gainesville, are you?
No, I am not in Gainesville. I am once again with you in Washington, D.C.
And what are you doing here?
Just finished a study section where we missed you terribly.
I can't believe it for a moment that you would miss me or anyone would. Maybe my family would miss me.
Yeah. So since I was here, we decided to get together again.
Yeah. So I thought since you're coming, we might as well do TWiVs with people who are in the area.
It's just a train ride for you, right?
Train ride, 2 hours. It's very quick. Easy to come down, easy to go back. And today we are in the office of a senior investigator in the National Center for Biotechnology Information, better known as NCBI, which is part of the National Library of Medicine at the NIH. Eugene Koonin, welcome.
Hello, Vincent.
Or maybe...
And welcome to the NCBI. Oh,
thank you very much.
And hello, Rich, and welcome to the NCBI,
thank
too.
Thank you, Eugene.
I'm very... pleased, I should say delighted, to have both of you here in my office, and thank you for doing this.
Pleasure. Sure. I've been wanting to talk to you for a long time, years ago, 2009.
I recall that conversation that somehow has not been followed through.
So part of the problem is we can't do Skype with people on the NIH campus.
Actually, these days, apparently you can.
Oh, they
it requires it. Some special installation, but apparently you can.
You can do it. So that's why I got discouraged years ago. And then I saw you at the giant DNA virus meeting in Tegernsee last fall. And I said, we have to do a TWiV with Eugene. So here we are.
That's correct.
That was very good. So I want to talk to you all about viruses and the work you do. But first, I want to get an idea of your history, where you came from, and how you got here. So where were you born?
Yes. Let's be completely candid about this and explain where and when.
Sure.
So I was born in the city of Moscow in the fall of the year 1956. In those very days when the Soviet tanks entered Budapest. So my mother, while having me in the hospital, was listening in terror to that translation. And I spent the first 35 years, with some quick interruptions, but I spent the first 35 years of my life in Moscow.
Mm-hmm.
Still in the country, all these years, still in the country, that was known as the Soviet Union. And this is where I attended school, and then university, the prime university in that country, Moscow State.
Right.
And there I was lucky enough. It was not easy actually to be accepted at the biology department, and in my sophomore year. I have chosen the Department of Virology. It's better to say that it was a school of biology and the Department of Virology, and I have chosen that for my specialization. To begin with, not so much because of my special interest in viruses, of which I had relatively little at that time, but because of the reputation of the department as a group of liberal professors.
Okay.
I think, though, that the choice was very lucky. My interest in my very special interest in viruses increased very rapidly at the time and remains extremely high to this day.
Did you know Vadim Agol?
I came to know him very, as a matter of fact, he was another reason why I joined that department, and not only because of the liberal reputation, but because even in my freshman year, I actually read one of his articles in a Russian journal, sort of a review article in a Russian journal, and that impressed me very much because it was sort of a very well-structured article where he tried to predict different classes, different types of viruses, sort of trying to be a Mendeleev of virology. Mm-hmm. Not super successfully, but still it was an impressive attempt to me at the time. And that impressed me because it was not descriptive, like most of the works that I was familiar with, but well-structured and somewhat quantitative. And so I liked that very much, and this was one of the reasons I joined that department. And then I had the honor to become Vadim's student and work with him for years.
So you did your PhD work in this department?
Yes, both my master degree, okay, and PhD.
Okay, and what was your PhD on?
And my PhD was on the replication of the genomic RNA of picornaviruses.
Okay,
Which one? Any one in particular?
Most of the work was done on encephalomyocarditis viruses, okay, EMC, which has become important in biotechnology much later.
Sure. So I, of course, knew Vadim's work because I worked on poliovirus. I have my whole career, in fact, worked on polio. But I never met him until maybe it was the late 90s he was able to travel finally.
Late 90s?
Is that correct?
No.
When was it?
It was considerably earlier. Late 80s.
Late 80s he began to travel.
I remember that very clearly, 88 or 89.
Okay. None of us had seen him before, and then all of a sudden he was everywhere.
Not quite so. Because some people actually, some people, or prominent people, or unfortunately not you at the time, came to Moscow and met him and all of us back in 1980.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that was truly the first encounter.
Yeah, yeah.
It was a very unique symposium that was quite difficult to organize, but in retrospect, I should say it was worth it.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I didn't go to that one.
No, you didn't.
But I met him many years later, and since I've seen him many, many times at different meetings, he came to Columbia and gave a talk, actually. It was very good. So you finished your PhD in Moscow?
That's correct.
And then what did you do after that?
And after that, I actually stayed as what we may now call a postdoctoral fellow, and then a more senior fellow, in Vadim's lab for another 5 years after my PhD. And during those 5 years, I made a gradual transition that was, I think, completely critical for my own career, namely the transition from experimental virology to computational biology and study of comparative genomics and evolution.
So about what time, what year about would this have been, roughly?
I defended my PhD at the end of 1983, and right after that, the transition began.
So that is really around the beginnings of what we now know as computational biology, is that right? That's pretty early in the trail.
Early days,
right.
Although I would not truly say beginnings.
Okay.
Because looking back at that time, computational biology was already 20 years old.
Okay. Mm.
Exactly 20 years old. It was really obscure at the time. Not many people knew about it, but very important work has been done already.
Were you self-taught or did you learn from others?
I was to a large extent self-taught, and then I did learn from others, but those others were self-taught too. I wasn't educated in that field formally at all, and that was really not of my fault because there was no way. And I don't think there are many faults with the Soviet Union, but that, I think, is not one of them. There was no way to formally study the discipline, if it could be called that at the time, anywhere in the world.
Mm. Okay.
So I think of computational biology, especially in the current context, as and with the work you do, as mostly comparing nucleic acid sequences or implied protein sequences. What was computational biology before we could sequence nucleic acids?
To answer your question in a precise way, before people could sequence nucleic acids, they could sequence proteins by Edman degradation.
Okay.
And that was enough for some very prescient scientists such as Niels Åkerkando or Margaret Dayhoff to launch what we now know as computational biology, which, you are right, at its core has comparison of sequences. At that time, primarily directly determined protein sequences.
Right. So it must have been a huge explosion in the field when all of a sudden we could sequence DNA.
Absolutely. After approximately 1980, 2 or 3 years after the modern era of sequencing began with Sanger and Gilbert, there was a huge explosion, the huge explosion started. So I was really late to the table by 3 or 4 years.
Okay. That's not very late.
Not bad.
Not terribly, no.
I sequenced the genome of polio in 1981. I was at MIT.
Yes.
And we had minimal software to be able to, the only thing we could do was assemble the sequence pieces. I did it by Maxim and Gilbert. We could assemble them on a computer. I had to use an acoustic coupler.
I did the same thing.
Do you remember acoustic couplers?
Honestly, no.
You don't remember?
No.
Anyway, you took a telephone and you put it on this device that had two holders for the top and the bottom, and then the modem signals, the handshaking signals, went through that to the, to the computer, and I could put my sequences on, and there was a program by Roger Staden.
Oh, yeah.
I used the same thing. Staden program, yeah. They used the same
thing. Oh, yeah.
And we did the same thing. We had the acoustic coupler that 300 baught, I think it was, to send our sequences to the computer.
It was so funny. But there was, once you had a genome, there was not much you could do with it because there weren't...
You could translate it, though.
You could translate it,
there
right?
There was some program coming, maybe from Staden, maybe from Pustel or whoever at the time to translate.
Pustel, that was another one. And then, then eventually the Wisconsin package was developed of sequence analysis programs.
Yeah.
GCG, I think it was called.
Oh, GCG, it had a long life since then. I think it's defunct now, but not for long.
But of course, you couldn't blast. There was nothing to blast against, or it was very little, right?
There was precious little to blast again. Or I can, you know, tell you about how we did these things back in 1984, even 85.
Yeah.
There was no acoustic coupler. So I had to type in the sequences.
Right. Okay, directly.
Directly.
Right.
Well, for a couple of years, this was how we did it.
Yeah.
Primarily already translated protein sequences, but sometimes nucleotide sequences.
Mm-hmm.
Interestingly, Eugene, I spoke of the sequencing that Ed and I did. That was the HindI-3 defragment in Vaccinia. And that's where D5 comes from, and D13. Those were the original sequences
for
that.
Yeah.
We had no idea that they would turn out to be these core proteins. We'll get to that.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. So how long did you spend in, it was still the Soviet Union, correct?
It was still the Soviet Union.
As a, learning bioinformatics before you came here?
Learning bioinformatics, and I I really dislike that word, by the way.
What do you prefer? What's a better word?
Computational biology, computational genomics.
Okay.
The computational molecular biology, any of that.
Okay.
So, in any case, I spent approximately 7 years since starting to learn that craft until moving to the United States.
What year was that you came here?
I came here in 1991, joining the NCBI in November of that year, 1991.
At that time, how old was NCBI?
Quite young. It was nominally 2 years old, but in terms of the actual existence of organization, less than that. It existed for about a year by that time.
And how did you manage to get this job?
It was an interest. It's a curious story in itself.
Okay.
It requires a brief description of two or three steps.
Okay.
But they are very relevant to virology, so
okay.
I can tell you about that. So in the August of 1990, I attended my first serious international scientific meeting. And that was the Congress of Virology, which took place in West Berlin in the August of 1990. So by that time, we have done quite a bit of work on evolution of small virus, on comparative genomics and evolution of small viruses, and made a variety of predictions on protein functions and got the idea of the evolutionary tree of these viruses. There was indeed, it was a good time. There was a lot of results, and so I submitted the abstract to that Congress and even got an oral presentation and some grant to attend. So it worked well. So this was my first real serious scientific meeting abroad, or anywhere for that matter. All of a sudden I met, you know, the entire who is who in virology. Right there in the International Center of Congresses in Berlin. And in particular, well, I think I have to mention, actually, that I did not travel alone. I traveled with a colleague of mine named Valerian Dolial, who remains one of my best friends and closest collaborators ever since.
He's now in Oregon?
Oregon State, correct. Okay. Corvallis. Yes. And we keep doing many things together. So we came together. It was a pleasure to travel that way. And we spoke to many virologists, and in particular to a gentleman named Jim Carrington.
Mm-hmm.
Who is quite a well-known plant virologist. He was a very young assistant professor at Texas A&M University at the time. Since then, he had quite an illustrious career. So we spoke to that man, and I happened to do something that was somewhat important. Right there, in the corridors of the Center for Congresses. Jim had some experimental evidence that a particular piece of a polyprotein encoded by a particular plant virus might have a protease activity. But in database comparisons, various sequence comparisons, that perhaps in a crude form but were already feasible at the time, he could not see any relationship to any proteases whatsoever, or to anything else for that matter. It was just an obscure sequence. So I had a good look at that sequence. Unfortunately, there were two or three sequences from related viruses, so I could trace some sequence conservation. And right there, without having any computer, of course, just by hand, by writing one sequence underneath the other, I managed to identify the active site of that protease, to tell him what kind of protease this was, and which specific serine residue had to be mutated to abrogate the activity, and so on. All this turned out to be quite correct a little later. So that was our discussion. There were many other discussions. I think my talk there went fairly well. And then I had a chance to actually apply a hammer to the Berlin Wall, got a piece with me, and returned to Moscow. It was one of the biggest surprises of my life. Then about a week or maybe two after my return to Moscow from that meeting, I received a fax from Jim Carrington, which invited myself and Valerie and Dola to visit him for about 3 months in College Station, Texas A&M University, more or less at our earliest convenience, to continue the collaboration on that protease and other things. So this is how it came to be, and this was the time when it was already possible to leave the Soviet Union and come back and without any repercussions. So in February of 1991, Valerian and I flew from Moscow to New York, from New York to Dallas, and from Dallas to College Station.
I would think going from Moscow to College Station would be a shock.
It was, especially as when we then a very small plane, American Eagle plane, very small one, started from Dallas towards College Station. There was a horrible thunderstorm, and I was this was the most turbulent flight of my life, and I have done quite many flights since. I was really expecting that the Texas Prairie was going to be my grave. somehow, by more or less miraculously, it hasn't become it. So we landed at College Station. It was a shock, you're quite right. Especially it was almost hot in College Station. Mm-hmm. Freezing in Moscow, almost hot there. And this was, I think, a successful visit in College Station for a little less than 3 months. For myself, Valerian stayed considerably longer. During that visit, I kind of realized that probably this was the country to work in. If you wanted to be serious about doing some of that science I was so interested in, this was the country to come to, probably. I really didn't have that in mind when starting the visit, but it has become quite apparent to me. And so I sent letters to various people, 5 or 6 different places, which I thought were conducive to what I wanted to do. It was just a sheer piece of good luck that I read a little article that I recall that was published in the journal Genomics about the new Center for Computational Biology that was just organized at the NIH. And then, in a different journal, I read another paper that described a piece of software that was produced there for protein sequence alignment. And from the description of that software, I realized that this is something that I really wanted to use. This was good. It was actually quite similar to something that we developed ourselves back there in Russia, but somewhat more sophisticated. So I thought that this was something that I needed. So I wrote a letter to the guy who was the first author on that paper about this piece of software. Without really realizing very much who you want to address and so on and so forth. Who was junior, who was senior. I didn't quite figure that out. I just wrote him a letter saying that I think this was a good program for multiple line, at least I hope so, and I was really, really eager to try that, and maybe it could be received from them. And by the way, I would be also very interested to perhaps develop a longer-term association with the NCBI, something like that. So I sent that letter and proceeded with what I did in College Station, and in a day or two, I received another fax from a gentleman named John Wooton, who was not the guy who I addressed, a different person here, or a much more senior person, one of the faculty here at the NCBI. Yes, and I think I also enclosed my CV with that first letter. And so I received that fax that expressed some interest in my visit to the NCBI in order to explore the areas for possible collaboration, something like that. So in April of 1991, I came to Bethesda for the first time to go through this interview process and give my seminar. So I think I gave the least successful, most tedious seminar of my life. at least I think so, because I really had I don't blame myself too harshly, because I had very limited experience of how these things should be done. On top of that, I was so excited about those sequences, so I pretty much explained them letter by letter. In the single amino acid code, which was not so exciting to the people in the audience, was not a very good talk. But apparently I did manage to explain that I knew something about proteins and about the evolution and could be useful in that capacity. So in any case, the result of that interview was an invitation to join the NCBI for 2 years in a position of visiting scientist, which is really something like a senior glorified postdoc. Very open-ended, with, I wouldn't say no chance, but very little chance of any continuation. It was implied that it would be those 2 years, perhaps three. So we came, I managed to go back to Moscow for a few months, participate in the August coup, or was it a revolution? I'm not sure now. And then come here to Bethesda with my family, my wife and daughter, in November 1991. And, well, the rest, as they say, is history.
You're still here.
I'm still here after almost 23 years.
Yeah.
Things gradually after some relatively difficult accommodation period, things really took off for me here, and I sort of graduated from the temporary position to a longer-term one, and then to a tenured one, in which I remain here, as you mentioned in the beginning of our conversation today.
So we now know NCBI as a really amazing website. It has GenBank, it has PubMed, has lots of tools for almost everything you would want. Were you involved in the development of any of these, or was that other people?
No, I made some contributions. This is not my main task, but in particular, I made some contributions to the statistics of the BLAST search, which is important now, as well as to some of the databases. I wouldn't say major contributions, but tangible ones.
So this history really puts some things in perspective for me. This is great. I was telling you before we went on that one of the major advances in my own understanding of one of the genes that I work on that's important to me, this vaccinia virus A18 gene, came from Eugene's computational biology analysis of vaccinia protein genes. And this is his first paper on vaccinia virus protein genes, discovering putative DNA or RNA helicases in the virus in 1992. So that was not long after you got here. And that opened it up for us because it fingered A18 as a helicase and inspired a bunch of experiments that we did that helped figure out what it does. That's great.
Yes, I remember that, but I'm really very pleased to hear it directly.
It really worked out for us, and it's interesting for me now to have all that in perspective.
Sure, of course. So now you don't do wet experiments in your lab, correct?
None at all.
You use computers, and you think a lot. You use your brain, and you publish a lot of papers about that work. Okay.
We try to use our brain, but computers are essential.
Do you do any software development?
Yes, okay. We do some software and database development. Okay. Indeed, it's not my primary goal. It's means to an end. My end is really understanding evolution.
Right. So if you need some new computational tools and you need to develop them.
But we do need some new computational tools. Not very, I wouldn't say, you know, the very fundamental computational tools. But oftentimes we do need to apply a new statistical technique or a new pipeline that ties together in a new way existing computational tools, that sort of thing. We need this very often, so we do that. We also need some data collections, some databases that are different from what exists, and we develop these.
So when I look over your website from NIH that describes projects in your laboratory, there's a portion of your interest that's focused on viruses, and a significant fraction, at least looking at the website, on non-viral genes, eukaryotic genes and whatever. What can you describe to me where the focus is? Do viruses play a big role still in your interests?
Absolutely. Viruses play a very important part in my interests and are one of the key directions of the lab. Without being too modest, I would say that my goal and my research program, if you will, is to understand something sensible about evolution in general.
Okay.
About evolution of life. Viruses are, in my firm opinion, extremely important for in the evolution of life. It's not my personal history at all. I mean, it's lucky that I had this personal history, but that's not the issue.
Right.
The issue is that viruses are really extremely important for all evolution of life, and I think the real impact is only beginning to be appreciated broadly in the biological community.
Okay, good.
So it is a very important part, although we work in several other directions as well.
Okay. So I want to focus on the viral part of your work because that's what we do on this podcast. And I read a paper that you and Dolja wrote together called A Virocentric Perspective on the Evolution of Life. And I think this can make a nice framework for our discussions with some incursions or excursions elsewhere.
Indeed.
And what I would like to do is somehow talk with you about the origins, what we think are the origins of viruses, and your thoughts on that, which you talk about extensively in this articles. So, and you have a very, so you have a very specific idea of where viruses came from. Can you elaborate that just to start us off?
Of course I can. So yes, I have a very particular view of where viruses come from, and I can elaborate, but first to put it in a nutshell, I think that viruses evolved, that the principal groups of viruses, the principal types of viruses, evolved directly from the primordial pool of the earliest genetic elements.
So this would be precellular life, is that right?
Yes, this is effectively correct. We do not know just how precellular or how protocellular okay. that is. And there are very different scenarios that are entertained, from being completely precellular, from these elements of inhabiting inorganic compartments, rather than any entities resembling modern cells, to somewhat less radical scenarios that kind of put them into various kinds of lipid vesicles with perhaps sort of primitive membranes that at least to some extent resemble modern cells. But I think it's fairly clear that it's not in the era of full-fledged cells that viruses evolved, but rather before.
Mm-hmm.
This really ties up with the most general theoretical foundations of evolutionary biology, which make it completely clear that no replication system of any, no system of replicators of any appreciable complexity can exist without developing parasites and accordingly some means of resistance. So pretty much as soon as there were any kind of replicating nucleic acids, let it be RNA bound or perhaps some other model of early evolution, there were parasites. And some adaptations that allow the entire replicator system not to collapse under the load of these parasites. These parasites may not be the most primitive forms of these parasites may not be considered real viruses. At least superficially, they might have resembled those molecules that now are known as viroids.
Okay. Plant
pathogens primarily. But that really was the beginning of the world of selfish elements, of the bigger virus world, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So that's my framework of trying to understand evolution of viruses. And because, as we already stated, parasites started together with hosts. They're really inseparable in evolution. Because of that, the study of the evolution of selfish elements is really the study of the evolution of life.
Interesting.
Could you define a selfish element?
Yes. A selfish element, element is the kind of element that relies on some other replicator for at least one component that is essential for its replication.
Okay. It's not the same as a selfish gene, for example, because our genes are called by some selfish, but that's not
it's
your
an interesting point. I would still say that the Dawkins notion of the selfish gene is more of a metaphor than anything else. The selfish, well, it depends on how you view this. I think that when we consider selfish elements, according to the definition that I just mentioned to you, we are on a much firmer ground. It's actually very easy to define these selfish elements. But then, of course, these selfish elements are, at least many of them, or most of them, are not completely selfish. They have the capacity to provide, to enter something more like symbiotic, a mutualistic relationship with the host. So you may put it in another way. These parasites are systematically recruited by their host for some functions. So of course you can speak of any gene as possessing some degree of selfishness. Let's say, roughly speaking, from 0 to 1, on the scale from 0 to 1, where 0 is a gene that is never amplified, never becomes part of any kind of distinct element, and so on and so forth. And at 1, we have bona fide viruses. So, I suppose any gene can be assigned a value on that scale of selfishness, which is also the scale of altruism in the other direction. But many and many genes of cellular life forms are very close to zero on that scale. They're probably not zero, really, because we all know of gene amplification. Of course, much of evolution occurs by duplication, and in the prokaryotic world, so much of evolution occurs by horizontal gene transfer. All these are manifestations of selfishness. So they are not zero, but still, they do not encode devices for their own replication, let's say. They don't actively steal the replication machinery of the host. So, in my rough thinking, they are much closer to one, and there is probably some gap in that distribution. It's continuous, but there is, it's more like a U-shaped distribution, if you imagine it.
Okay.
So, one of the things that really captured my attention in looking over this material is this figure that you have in the Current Opinions article on the virocentric perspective on the evolution of life. And I think it's the last figure where you have the virus empire.
I don't get to open it. I remember it fairly well.
Right. I just love this because I've always thought that, well, I've long thought that viruses are their own evolutionary entity, right? Independently of other kingdoms, at least. And this really illustrates that, but in a different way. It's almost, are you proposing in this, I have several questions about this. Are you proposing in this that really another, in a way, taxon above kingdom, that is empire, that differentiates on the one hand between viruses and cellular life?
In a word, yes.
Okay.
So I really do think that there is a single fundamental divide among the organisms that exist in this biosphere, and that is the divide between self-sufficient cellular life forms and selfish elements, viruses and other kinds of selfish elements. This is the most fundamental separating line among the known life forms. So I don't really care that much about, you know, formal taxonomy. But I like to call them empires, which is a word that comes, I think, from Ernst Mayr originally. But later the people call it something else. But I think that this is the single most fundamental divide. Then if you look a little deeper, but only a little deeper into taxonomy, there are these three domains of cellular life, things that are, by the way, not called kingdoms, sometimes super kingdoms,
okay,
but usually domains.
Okay.
And these are obviously bacteria, archaea, and eukaryotes.
Okay.
And I think that classification is quite solid. We may, it's not our subject today. There are all kinds of debates on evolution of eukaryotes in which I participate. But this is not our issue today. These three types of cells, three domains of cellular life do exist. They're quite objective. They can be delineated very objectively. From that perspective, from the kind and degree of the differences and similarities, we could also look on at the other side, at the selfish or viral side of the world. And if we do so, I think the only conclusion that we may arrive at, the only sensible conclusion we may arrive at, is that the viral empire also is naturally divided into several domains. And actually, it's more than three. Because unlike cellular life forms, despite all their diversity, viruses actually use different replication cycles. We have several groups of RNA viruses, positive strand RNA viruses that pack the positive polarity, roughly speaking, mRNAs, into the variants. We have negative strand RNA viruses that pack the RNA of the opposite negative polarity and accordingly also need to pack RNA polymerase for their replication. We have then double-stranded DNA RNA viruses. Then we have things like retrotranscribing elements and viruses, those that you have the reverse transcription stage in their replication cycles. And we have small, single-stranded DNA viruses. Many or most of them also use their very specific modality of DNA replication, known as rolling circle. And then we have larger DNA viruses. These are this is the classification by genomic strategy. And then this, of course, is overlaid by evolutionary relationships that we and others try to tease out by comparing genomes and particle structures of these viruses. And these classifications overlap partially, but not completely. Because, for instance, it seems like double-stranded RNA viruses, different groups of double-stranded RNA viruses evolved on multiple occasions from different groups of positive-stranded RNA viruses. It's not 100% clear how many of these domains of viruses are optimally delineated, but it's more than cellular life forms. It's at least five or six of these domains, which I think, in terms of the degree of internal coherence and different, and the level of difference from other domains, are as legitimate and as natural as the three domains of cellular life.
Why is it that viruses have explored the entire genomic space, but all other organisms on the planet are double-stranded DNA?
Well, I think that there are coherent mechanistic and evolutionary reasons behind this. That is, the very clear mechanistic reasons. RNA is fragile. You cannot really make a very large genome of RNA. To the very best of our knowledge, the largest that exist are about 35 kb.
And even those need editing functions to keep
even going. Those already start needing editing functions. It's difficult to make a large genome of single-stranded RNA, of any kind of RNA, or even single-stranded DNA. And we know in order for a cell to function, you need at least a few hundred genes, roughly speaking about 1,000 genes, and that means a DNA of about a megabase. In order to make a free living cell, which does not parasitize another cell, you need about that much.
Okay.
It's sort of physically impossible to make these large genomes of any material other than double-stranded DNA. But also it's, I think, very hard and probably unnecessary to reject the notion that viruses in this diversity of genomic strategies reflect their primordial attempts on evolution of different kinds of genomes. Especially if we stick to the idea of the RNA world as the beginnings of life's evolution. And I think, the RNA world is much like democracy, quite a bad hypothesis, but less bad than any others.
Right.
So it's really cool that viruses are sort of exploring evolutionary space, trying to figure out what the possibilities are,
sure.
Right?
Yes, I think that's a good way to describe it, and it's very hard to get away from that idea. I simply put, I think that's a valid idea.
Do you think that that DNA viruses emerged before DNA cells or after DNA cells?
Say anywhere that any kind of viruses emerged before cells, we immediately get heat from semantic purists because among who there are very reasonable people too, in the sense that viruses are obligate intracellular parasites, and therefore viruses existing before cells is nonsense. So I actually sort of take the point and prefer to speak of virus-like elements or virus-like entities or whatever that existed before cells. That said, I do very firmly believe that DNA-based small elements that were virus-like by many accounts evolved before cells. Actually, it's very difficult to imagine how it could have been otherwise, because that accretion should have taken place before the really large genomes evolved.
But as you point out, the minute you have anything that looks cellular, you're going to have parasites on that. So there's going to be beyond that point, there's going to be a co-evolution of these things and an exchange of information, right?
And there surely was, and there is, and there will be.
Right. Okay.
What's the minimum genome for parasitization? Do we have an idea?
You mean the minimum host genome? Well, yes. We have an idea. And I think that in order to not to become completely theoretical, I think the sort of upper bound of that minimal entity is shown to us by certain satellite viruses. Well, actually, for that matter, not even by satellite viruses, by viroids, right? Viroids are the ultimate parasites, pretty much. Their RNA molecules of only about 400 nucleotides that do not encode any proteins. Mm-hmm. That do not that do not encode any proteins, but that do have some ribozyme activity. replicate their genomes by recruiting cellular enzymes, in particular DNA-dependent RNA polymerase, or, by the way, other kinds of viroids, RNA-dependent RNA polymerase of small viruses. So we have this tiny little thing, like 400 nucleotides, that effectively is a parasite of another little thing, of a virus that may have about 5 or 6 kilobases in its genome only. That, of course, is also a parasite of a plant. So it's a triple system. But it still shows us that the tiny little thing can be a parasite of another little thing, not even caring very much about the big host. So I think this is sort of close to the ultimate parasitism. Entities that do not encode anything other than, that's very important, signals for their own replication.
So if the ultimate parasite is very small and doesn't code for anything, why do we have huge parasites that have millions of base pairs and thousands of genes, right? Why do they exist? Why did they evolve?
That's a fantastic question, to which I would dearly love to have a good answer, and I don't. I would put it this way, that there are these two strategies in the world of parasites. They're to some extent mimicked also in the world of cellular life forms, but become especially striking among the parasites. And one is really the tendency to minimization and maximum efficiency. It's, I think, easy to understand that although there are these ultimate parasites like viroids that do not encode anything, there are clear advantages to encoding something, encoding your own capsid protein in particular and your own polymerase. That makes you, as a virus, much more independent from the fate of the host and much more capable of transmission. So much more successful in the evolutionary sense. That is very understandable. Beyond that, however, your question is a burning one. Why there are others that do not follow the trend of minimization, but rather follow the trend of increasing sophistication? I do not really know. I do know, that many, if not most, of the genes in these large viral genomes encode proteins, sometimes also even RNAs, that are involved in various phases of the virus-host interaction. Some viruses, speaking in deliberately anthropomorphic terms, in the evolution strategy, choose to pack as little as possible into their genomes, but make these few things highly efficient, replicate as fast as they can, and sort of run away from the host before the host manages to get them or to commit suicide. Others go by in a different, much more elaborate, go down a different and much more elaborate path of accumulating a variety of functions that modify the different host machinery, such as translation and transcription, proteolysis and others, to sort of serve the virus purposes that really keep the host alive, do not allow it to commit suicide, and so on, interact with the host in highly sophisticated ways. What, in the course of evolution, what puts some parasites on one road and the others on the other? What triggers the decision to follow one of these strategies? Is, I think, a big question to which I do not have a good answer. I still hope to get it.
Okay. So I'm thinking of Dixon. He's saying all these things are safe crackers, right? So we got a couple of different kinds of safe crackers. We got the sneak thief.
That's right.
Who gets in and gets out. And then we have the thug who goes in and just, you know, blows up the safe.
Sledgehammer. Right. That's a pox virus. Pox viruses and above have sledgehammer approaches.
So
that's correct.
A lot of what you've done, or some of what you've done, is comparative genomics, comparative viral genomics, and looking at what seems to me identifying relationships by these comparisons, and also it seems to me identifying a minimal set of genes that at least are common to lineages of viruses, but it almost looks to me like minimal set of genes that are sufficient for self-replicating entities. I wonder if you could elaborate on some of that. I'm interested in the core genes and what you get out of the comparative genomics.
I certainly can elaborate on these issues. And what you said indeed is correct, and that's, by the way, not limited to viruses at all. That's the at the core of all comparative genomics. We compare multiple genomes and we identify core genes that are shared by all or nearly all members of a certain class of life forms, and the so-called, so to speak, periphery or shell of less common genes that are present only in narrow groups. And again, you are right in saying that we identify the minimal set of genes that are required for replication with an important qualification, which harks back to what we discussed a moment ago about different evolutionary strategies. Because we identify a minimal set of genes that are required to be a replicating agent of a certain kind. For instance, a cell, to take an example from the other side. But also, for instance, to be, let's say, a cytoplasmic large DNA viruses in a eukaryotic, parasitizing eukaryotic cells. For if I describe the requirements in that manner, yes, we can identify the set of core genes that are present in all or nearly all of these viruses, and apparently by inference, and sometimes, which is on many occasions corroborated by experimental evidence, are indeed required for this type of replication. Moreover, we come to the rather startling conclusion that this kind of viruses evolved only once in the entire history of life.
Interesting. Okay.
Now, from my incursion into your field, which is not ours, I see there's some people who feel that viruses started big and got small, at least some viruses. They actually left cells with a lot of genes and then slowly threw them away. And then I understand your idea is that they began small and acquired genes, right? Is that a fair representation of two?
Almost.
Okay.
Inevitably, in an evolution of any diverse groups of organisms, both processes take place, both expansion and contraction. Yet, your description is largely accurate in the sense that from my own reconstructions of virus evolution, I gather that they started somewhat small, and at least the really big genomes on the viral scale are results of scavenging a variety of genes from hosts and from fellow symbionts.
So the very, very big DNA viruses, for example.
Indeed.
The most recently described ones, the Mimes and
Pandoras.
Pandoras, and the most recent, the
Pithovirus.
Yeah. A million base pairs, and well, the Pitho is 600,000.
Yeah, right? It's a little smaller one.
So these have a lot of, so many of these genes we don't even recognize, correct?
Oh, that is, we don't recognize what kind of protein they encode.
Right.
That's correct.
Right. But some are tRNA encoding genes, tRNA synthetases, other proteins.
As well as tRNAs themselves, by the way.
tRNAs themselves. So these are clearly acquired from hosts. Is that, can we say that with certainty?
Yes, we can.
Okay, because hosts have these genes, right?
Not only, because that's in general. But we do phylogenetic analysis. We build specific phylogenetic trees, and we can see, for the majority of them, with confidence, what kind of host they come from.
Okay. So the idea would be that at some point these viruses acquired these tRNAs, for example, the tRNA-encoding genes. But in evolution, my understanding is you don't plan for the future, you plan for the moment. So why at a moment in a cell would a viral genome acquire these? What would be the need?
Well, in a certain sense, in evolution, you don't even play for or plan for the moment. You don't plan, period. You just take advantage of some opportunities that come your way. Whatever is incorporated into a viral genome or any other genome is incorporated there because it can. Or the pertinent question is, why does it stay there? Why is it fixed in the course of evolution? And moreover, not just fixed in the narrow sense of population genetics, but fixed there, remains there for hundreds of millions of years. That is a very good question. So once acquiring, let's say, a tRNA genes, viruses discover that with that gene, apparently by complementing the A-link host translation system, they can do better. They can produce more progeny than their cousins that have not acquired that gene. Hence, natural selection. Hence, these genes survive for such a long time. We cannot always, in the case of translation components, let's say, that have become famous with respect to these giant viruses, at least we have a fairly clear idea of how they may help. On other occasions, we don't. But I think as long as they persist for many millions of years, it implies completely that there is an advantage, that there is a disadvantage in losing them. Even if we, and it's a challenge to figure out these functions as best we can.
So when I was in Tegernsee, I did a podcast with Claveri and Abergel, and they're very insistent on the idea that these viruses did not acquire them. They say it makes no sense to acquire a gene because you don't know what you're going to need. Their idea is that absolutely it started big and it is losing genes, right? Yeah. But you're saying that probably both mechanisms are at play, right?
Both mechanisms, I think we should be pretty clear about this. Both mechanisms are at play in the sense that viruses acquire genes, viruses lose genes. Or they become big, and sometimes they become smaller. After being big, they become smaller. That for sure happens. But this is sort of a very weak version of that hypothesis of complex ancestors. The strong version, in the case of viruses, I will just put it very plainly, I think makes no sense. Jean-Michel Claveri and others are trying to say is that these viruses actually started as cells. Not just, any of the cells we are directly familiar with, but some kind of fourth domain, mysterious, extinct fourth domain of cellular life. Now, that idea, I think, has zero support in any data. Moreover, although they are claiming that these universal cellular genes, such as tRNA synthetases, in these viruses come from some kind of, from nowhere, from some kind of fourth domain, this is simply a result of bad phylogenetics. They don't. The majority of them can be clearly shown to come from eukaryotic cells and nowhere else.
So as I recall, this idea of a fourth domain comes from looking at some of these large cytoplasmic DNA viruses, and what was it? I think it was Pandora.
And Mimi.
And not being able, and discovering a number of genes that had, according to them, no matches in the database. Dark matter, if you like.
Yeah, okay? I do like that phrase, yes.
And so, what then are those genes?
All right. Before going into the dark matter, shall I maybe spend a couple of minutes describing this, fourth domain conundrum?
Okay.
So, the people really speak of this issue of the fourth domain in two somewhat different ways. One way is very vague. They kind of just say, these viruses are so big, they are sort of cell-like in their dimensions, they have physical size of the particles which are like small cells, and genomes which are like small cells. So they are so unusual. They have lots of these genes that are, at least if you don't look too carefully, appear to be dark matter. So where do they come from? From some unclear place where they existed as completely unusual life forms. This is a vague description of the fourth domain. Now there is, parallel to that, or in addition to that, there is a concrete and specific description. That concrete and specific description is steeped in Karl Bose's definition of the three domains of cellular life. That idea of three domains of cellular life did not come from any vague considerations, but from very specific phylogenetic analysis of ribosomal RNA molecules. Mm-hmm. Right. They form three branches. It's a plain fact. Anyone can reproduce it. They form three branches, corresponding to eukaryotes, bacteria, and archaea. Now, viruses do not encode ribosomal RNA, but these giant viruses are interesting in many ways, but in particular in that they encode some universal components of the translation systems. And it's also true that by and large, when you do phylogenetic analysis on these universal components of the translation system, they may, with some interesting exceptions, but by and large, the topology of the resulting phylogenetic trees mimics the topology of the ribosomal RNA tree, reproducing the separation of the three domains of cellular life. So within that framework, there is a claim that these giant viruses represent a fourth domain of cellular life. That claim is false, plainly false, because these genes show affinity to one of the known domains of cellular life, namely eukaryotes. As for the vague idea of the fourth domain, that's not a falsifiable hypothesis. I'm even sympathetic. As we discussed before, within this idea of this concept, rather, of this viral empire, there may be several domains, and large DNA viruses qualify as one of them. So there is nothing wrong about describing them in that manner. Coming back to the dark matter of the viral genomes, well, much like in cosmology. As most physicists these days believe, there is no single source of dark matter. It's really a compendium of several different things. Same, I think, in biology. They come from different sources. The main issue, I think, is that viral genes tend to evolve fast. For reasons that we partially do understand, because viruses come from through a large number of generations, they form at least periodically very large populations, which accelerates evolution. And then also purifying selection may be relaxed with respect to many of their genes. So they tend to evolve fast. So many of these dark matter genes, as far as I understand, are sort of runaways. They have taken these genes from some source, from some cellular source, ultimately, I believe, and then these genes have just changed beyond recognition. There are interesting examples in viruses of gene evolving from, so to speak, nowhere. Of course, not from nowhere literally, but from non-coding sequences. There are some such examples. So that very well, that is another source of dark matter. Also, we have to realize that in the evolution of giant viruses, the process of gene duplication is very important. It's not so important in smaller viruses. But in the large virus, in the largest viruses, it's about as important as it is in the evolution of cellular life forms. So you steal, let's say, one gene from somewhere, then it becomes dark matter by evolving, by running away in evolutionary terms, by evolving very fast, and then it's duplicated and makes a whole family of these dark things.
But the dark matter encodes protein, right?
Yes, primarily. Maybe a few small RNAs here and there, but largely proteins. Indeed, much like prokaryotic genomes, and even to a greater extent than that, the genomes of large viruses are, so to speak, wall-to-wall genomes. They are all covered rather neatly, rather tightly, by protein-coding genes.
So I have a technical question that come up previously. This dark matter that we're talking about, sequences that people come up with that don't match anything in a public database.
So this is is dark matter in a metagenomic sample or within a viral genome or both?
Both,
right?
Both.
Okay.
So it seems to me that people who determine sequence, you know, bulk sequence, and generate a lot of dark matter, there must be a number of different. Is there any central repository for dark matter? Is there any motivation really to compare different people's collections of dark matter sequence to see if there are commonalities? Is that worthwhile?
Let me first answer the last question. Definitely it's worthwhile. As for efforts, yes, there are efforts also. I wouldn't say there are repositories for dark matter specifically, and actually I don't think there should be.
Okay.
It's okay if dark matter is, you know, mixed with the stars and planets of the viral universe. As it is, let's say, in the metagenomic databases. But it's indeed very interesting to compare different parts of the dark matter between themselves in order to put some order into that, in order to recognize something, some new areas of higher density, some new protein families, and so on. And also, oftentimes, to recognize very distant relatives of something that we already know. It's common. It's common to recognize such things.
But the dark matter has a function for the viruses, correct?
Oh, largely. Once again, when you look at a giant viral genome, there very well may be a few genes there that have been acquired the day before yesterday.
Sure.
And they're not really fixed in the population, and they may not have a function. If, however, we are comparing viruses that are separated by any decent evolutionary distance, that let's say, you know, to put some kind of number on that, are have sequences that differ by 5% or something like that, even less maybe. We have a pair of conserved genes. Then these have some function.
Okay. So I remember the MIMI virus, when you passage it in amoeba, it undergoes extensive gene reduction.
Correct.
So this is maybe recently acquired genes that are not so important for the virus, or at least in that particular host, right?
That is absolutely correct. It actually sort of suggests that this amoeba may not be the natural host of the virus, or at least not the only natural host. Because indeed, these are relatively recently acquired genes, although that does not mean the day before yesterday. No, but they're not the most ancient genes, for sure. They tend to be always located closer to the ends of the genome rather than in the middle of the genome. And apparently they're indeed required only for replication in some hosts.
Now, so is this related to the fact that pithovirus genome is 600 kb, Pandora is 2.8, but the particles, the pitho is actually bigger particle than the Pandora. Is that because it's recently lost a lot of genes and the capsid hasn't caught up?
I don't know. I would not jump to that conclusion. It's kind of a neat idea, I would say, but I would not believe in it too easily.
I'm just curious about why it would be so small.
Or put another way, why these particles are so large.
Right. Well, for 2.8 million base pairs, I guess that's a good size for that, right?
Yeah, but for 600 kb, we know full well that there can be nice, you know, beautiful capsids rather than these strange, more amorphous particles.
Right.
You see, the pithovirus genome is small compared to Pandora. But when you look at its closer relatives, it's not closely related to Pandora at all. If you look at its closer relatives, such as iridoviruses and Marseille viruses, these have smaller genomes than pitho. So, of course, it is possible that there was or there still is somewhere out there something that is related to pithoviruses and even bigger. But we don't have evidence for that. What we do have evidence for is the existence of smaller relatives. So with the information that we have nowadays, we have to conclude that the pithoviruses actually expanded considerably, the pithovirus genome.
So I want to clarify a little background on this, because you've spent a fair amount of effort on these large nucleocytoplasmic viruses. And those would include pox viruses and these larger viruses of amoebae discovered in the last 10 years or so, MIMI and
Pandora.
More recently, Pandora virus, and then very recently, this pithovirus. We haven't talked about this on TWiV before, right? Because it's brand new. Pithovirus was pulled out of permafrost. Where did that come from?
In Siberia.
In Siberia, ironically.
In the very north of Siberia.
Okay, so permafrost that is 30,000 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And they have EMs of this stuff, and were able to cultivate out a fairly novel looking and taxonomically fairly novel virus that they call pithovirus. Now, how is one of your papers distinguishes Pandora virus from these other LCNDVs? Is that right? And I'm interested in that distinction.
Yes. This really needs a bit more background.
Okay.
Because to begin with, what are the NCODVs?
Okay. Good. Fine.
And why I think we are fully justified to call them to use a single name for this, whether okay. it's NCODV or Megaviralis or something else.
Right.
But they do represent a natural group, as taxonomists like to say, which means, in more tangible terms, that they have evolved from a common ancestor that was already a fairly complex virus that shared many characteristics with each of these groups.
And in fact, you have proposed that they be given a formal be an order, right?
Yes, indeed. We use the term megavirales, and there is resistance to this. I think it will prevail eventually, although probably not too soon. I don't really care that much
right.
about formal
right.
taxonomy, but I do care much about evolution and common
sure.
origin and such issues.
Right.
So I think it actually was something fairly important, I think, that we happened to do quite a long time ago by now, back in 2001. And that was showing that these viruses indeed share a core set of genes with common origin that, when put together in the present reconstruction, that's about 50 genes, comprise the nucleus of an ancestral viral genome. It probably had some additional genes. I'm sure it had some additional genes. But these genes were there, and they encode the majority of essential viral functions, or all of the essential viral functions, independent of the host. So that's evidence for the common origin, as evolutionary biologists like to say monophyly, of these nucleocytoplasmic large DNA viruses. Now, the conservation of that core notwithstanding, different families there are otherwise extremely different. They include pox viruses, so-called Asfar viruses, of which the type number is African swine fever virus, iridoviruses, ascoviruses, something known as phycodnaviruses, which are large viruses that infect various unicellular eukaryotes, in particular alga. Mimiviruses that, as far as we know, infect amoeba, but very possibly other unicellular eukaryotes as well. Now, Pandora viruses and these pithoviruses, and then something known as Marseille viruses, yet another group of distinct viruses infecting amoeba.
The megavirus also, right?
Megavirus is just part of the mimivirus.
Mimi, okay.
Yeah. And pithovirus falls into the same group?
They all fall into the same large class.
Fine.
But within the large class, there are indeed distinctions and differentiations.
Okay.
And particular branches. In particular, although Jean-Michel Couvreur claimed in his paper that Pandora viruses are not related to any other group of viruses, I think he was sort of hazy on the issue of the monophyly of the NCODV even, but in any case, beyond that, they, according to him, were unrelated to any other group. I think we can do better than that. And I think, Rich, this is the subject of the paper you were referring to,
mm-hmm.
Where we show that when the dust settles and we just take several core genes that are present in the Pandora viruses, they show a very clear evolutionary affinity. And that is to the to one of the groups that I mentioned a few moments ago, phycodna viruses. They're, to be more precise, within the family of phycodna viridae. And then there are smoking guns, so to speak, on that. Genes that are specifically shared with certain phycodna viruses. We have not done a similarly comprehensive analysis of the pizza viruses just yet, but I think on this occasion Couverie and his colleagues did better. In the phylogenetic analysis that they published, they indicated the relationship of these pizza viruses with the groups of iridoviruses and Marseille viruses. That is, I think, correct.
So you have this, one of the things I'm thinking about is this graph you have in this Biology Direct paper that graphs the number of core genes versus the number of protein-coding genes, and the Pandora viruses fall out of the major trend of these other viruses. And I think your conclusion is that although they are related to phycodna viruses, they are what you call highly derived phycodna viruses. Could you elaborate on that?
Yes, of course. If we take, if we look at the 50 core ancestral genes identifiable in the majority of the NCODV and by evolutionary reconstruction mapped to their common ancestor, some viruses have apparently lost some of these genes during the evolution. But mostly they lost only a few, perhaps replacing them with unrelated or distantly related genes of the same function, perhaps. Pandora viruses are real outliers in this. Despite their huge genomes, they have lost more than half of their ancestral genes. Nevertheless, I think what remains is fully sufficient classify them not only as NCODV, but as members of the Phycodna viridae family, even though, as you quoted, highly derived, in the sense that, you know, in evolutionary biology, derived means changed very significantly. In this particular case, losing many core genes.
So I want to check myself on another thing that caught my attention. Am I correct in having gotten out of this that one of the most, if not the most, conserved core gene is this ATPase that looks like a packaging ATPase?
That is absolutely correct.
So that fascinates me, that the most conserved thing would be the thing that is required for packaging DNA. Okay? That makes so much,
Do you think it makes so much sense? Does it make sense that an icosahedral particle and an amphora-like particle would all, both depend on that?
Well, you know, the pox viruses...
I'll elaborate on that.
Okay.
The pox viruses, well, go ahead, you elaborate.
All right. So that's quite interesting. Actually, these ATPases have a more complicated pedigree. They're not limited to NCODV. We actually detect them in many bacteriophages as well, in particular in the so-called tectiviruses, which is a specific family of bacteriophages that I think are sort of at the root of the NCODV. And they're also detected, their relatives, homologs, are also detected in bacteria, where these ATPases are sort of motors involved in DNA segregation during cell division. So you do not strictly need a capsid. Yet, there is very strong association. It's really a module, if you, of virus evolution, whereby this variety of packaging ATPase is linked to a specific variety of capsid protein known as double jelly roll. Both in bacteriophages and in the NCODV and in some other viruses too. Now, however, the only firm rule of biology, I believe, is that there are no firm rules. So look at Pandora viruses. The link is broken. They don't have a capsid protein at all. And we looked very hard to try and detect potential modified capsid derived capsid protein that might be involved in some intermediate stages of morphogenesis and so on and so forth, but it's simply not there. Yet, they encode not one, but four related packaging KT bases. That apparently one would, expect and predict that perform somewhat different roles somehow, split the labor in putting the DNA into that amphora-like particle. Now, the other amphora-like virus comes across. That's a pitha virus. Strangely enough, the pitha virus actually does encode a capsid protein. It's apparently not incorporated, not apparently part of these amphora-like particles. Possibly. It's part of some intermediate that is eliminated then, and the amphora virus particles are formed. But it does not encode the packaging KT base. So it does the thing, it certainly packages DNA, but it does that by some other means.
Interesting, okay.
So while these modules are quite stable in evolution, they are not absolutely stable.
The pox viruses, even though, well, I suppose you could argue that the immature particle is kind of like a capsid.
So
I guess packaging DNA, they do package DNA late during infection, and I suppose given that the capsid-like protein is there, that's not much different than packaging into a package, into a capsid.
Oh, I believe so. The capsid then is transformed into something else, and that
right.
ancestral protein is lost.
That's after the packaging. Okay.
So, from a computational biological evolutionary viewpoint, what new do we learn from pithovirus?
I am not quite sure yet because we have not studied it in full detail. It seems to miss. It's certain that it misses two essential genes from the ancestral set of the NCODV. One is the aforementioned packaging KT base. The other is disulfide bond reductase, which is a protein, oxidase reductase, which is an enzyme that is required for the formation of disulfide bonds in other NCODV.
That's an interesting loss.
Indeed it is, suggesting that there are no proteins with disulfide bonds in the in the virions of this virus, but this we have not tested. It's testable in principle, but we have not tested that just yet.
Yeah, the idea is that those would be required because the cytoplasm is an oxidizing environment, so they would be required for assembly in
sure.
the cytoplasm.
That's the idea, of course.
And it's not you don't get it from the host?
I guess
well,
not.
The host has a homolog, or more than one.
Yeah.
So in principle, it would be possible. The fact is that apparently even the ancestral NCODV has recruited this enzyme to be encoded in the viral genome.
Okay. So you said in one of your papers that we haven't discovered all the dark matter.
Of course not.
How much is left? Do we have do we have 1%? Do we have half? Do we have any way to know?
We most definitely do not have half. Much less. as for guessing at 1% or 2% or 10, I wouldn't really venture very confidently in this direction. So how do we even know? Well, it's fairly easy to understand in principle how, much harder to actually do it accurately. We do it by sampling. Just in about the same way zoologists used to, and botanists used to assess biodiversity since 19th century. You get some sample of, sufficiently large sample of something, let's say from metagenomes. You identify the genetic diversity, make sort of a catalog of the genetic diversity. Then you take another sample, yet another, and you see whether or not you are coming up repeatedly with the same genes. Based on how often, if you don't come up with repeated with the same genes, you really don't know how large is your universe, except that it's vast.
Right.
Huge. You're not even really tapping into it.
But don't they change also with time?
Oh, I mean, they change with time, indeed. But at any given time, the diversity is something. And if you are approaching saturation, you should be getting related things more and more often. There are some signs in metagenomic analysis of the full validity of which I'm not sure, that saturation might be within sight.
Which environments are we talking about?
Oh, that's a very good question. Primarily marine environments, but also some soil environments. So I have not done that myself, so I'm not entirely sure whether, for instance, animal guts were included into this analysis or not. But there are some signs coming up with the same genes repeatedly, suggesting that the universe is large but far from infinite. And that it may be only in the millions of genes. Of distinct genes, I mean, gene families.
Gene families.
Of course.
It's weird to think that we could get to a point where we've kind of sequenced everything.
I don't know if we will, because it's hard work to do, and it's not the kind of work that we only can do there. We have to do other work. But dark matter is in eukaryotic, prokaryotic, and archaeoviruses, is that correct? All three?
Oh, absolutely, of course. Of course. In eukaryotic bacteria and archaea, some archaeoviruses are particularly weird, particularly dark. Some of them almost don't have any bright spots.
That's good, I like that.
So, one or two per viral genome. So yes, there is a lot of dark matter, and I'm not confident yet about the robustness of these low estimates. It may be tens of millions of distinct genes.
It's amazing. It's just amazing. It's astounding.
It is astounding, indeed.
We had, and as you say in one of your papers, we had no clue of this before people started exploring the oceans, right?
Yes. The first metagenomes come from the oceans.
Amazing.
Indeed.
That's incredible.
Right.
It's very amazing. But as Rich pointed out a few moments ago, I do not think that it is entirely beyond belief that in our lifetime we might have quite a firm idea of how large this entire genetic universe is. I do not expect that it will be sequenced to the last gene or even to the last 2%. But once, you know, once we get to something, you know, well above 10%, we will have a very tight estimate of how large the whole thing is.
So you mean in our lifetimes in this room or in the lifetime of the planet?
No, I mean on our lifetime in this room.
There's a lot of sequencing going on, Vincent. Yeah. Plus, we did this paper a while ago about statistical extrapolations of how big something is based on a little
bit
of data.
Right, that's what Eugene is saying, 10% is enough
yes,
to
yes.
give you.
Yes,
yes. Okay.
At this time, maximum likelihood estimates become very reliable.
Okay. Now, I hate to jump around, but another question. We talked about the NCLDVs and a set of core genes that allow you to place them all in this order. Mm-hmm. Is the same for any bacteriophages? Can you do that?
To some extent. Bacteriophages are somewhat harder in that the genomes really are very fluid. They travel a lot between different bacteria, steal different genes from bacteria. It's quite difficult. It's fairly easy to identify a network of connections between different bacteriophages. It's hard to identify a core. I mean, for a large group, of course, for a group of fairly closely related bacteriophages. Yes, yes, we can, and you know the principles remain the same. But the whole thing is really more dynamic. And so we have done that work, really, trying to, and it was useful in many ways, identifying clusters of autologous bacteriophage genes. So I know for a fact that there is not a single gene that is shared by all bacteriophages, no, not even close. There are a few that are widespread, the majority are rare.
Is this because of a faster replication cycle or other aspects of the biology?
No, I think that's not much of an issue, faster replication cycle. What is more of an issue is that many of the bacteriophages integrate on a regular basis into bacterial chromosomes and then carry bacterial genes with them.
Okay.
And change all the time. And another issue is that for the replication of their genomes, at least the most common groups of bacteriophages, such as the lambda-like bacteriophages, for instance, use almost exclusively host genes. They have something to regulate the replication and expression, but overall, they use almost exclusively cellular host genes, and therefore they don't have many essential genes. They can lose things.
Can you identify core genes for groups of RNA viruses?
Yes. Yes, of course. RNA viruses are largely found in eukaryotes, as you know, where they're quite diverse. And there, yes, we very much can identify core genes, but as we already touched upon, these are small genomes. They only have like between 4 and 10 genes, most of them. And so the core is very small. And incidentally, most of the genome is occupied by the core, whereas in the large virus, it's a very small fraction of the genome.
Do you have any sense of how many founding lineages of RNA viruses there might be?
Yes, of course. We have a very good sense of that.
Okay.
There are effectively 4, I believe.
Okay.
Of positive strand RNA viruses.
Okay.
That's what I meant.
Okay.
But if you come to all RNA viruses, okay, the double-stranded RNA viruses, all of them, as far as we know, or come from different groups of positive strand RNA virus. So, that doesn't change the number of founding virus. As for negative strand RNA viruses, that's a difficult issue. Where they come from, I don't really know. I don't think anyone really knows. And there may be another three founding members there.
Okay. Interesting.
You said that RNA viruses are mainly limited to eukaryotes.
Primarily.
Do we understand why?
Not really. My own sort of pet view is that this is because of the nucleus, because it's much less straightforward for a virus to use, to make use of the host replication machinery. A few groups of DNA virus manage to do that. Others manage to become more independent, such as the NCODV. But as I mentioned, the NCODV emerged just once. It's not a trivial task. RNA viruses. Why they have such a diversity of RNA viruses in eukaryotes? Truth to be told, they are more common than DNA viruses in eukaryotes. And it's completely reversed in the prokaryotic world. There are very few small narrow groups of RNA viruses, mostly ODNA. I think this is primarily because RNA viruses don't stand a chance there. DNA viruses have ample opportunity to recruit the host replication machinery. Whereas in eukaryotes, this is becoming less straightforward, and against that background, RNA viruses become competitive.
Okay, you got a cytoplasmic compartment.
Yes, indeed.
Where you can replicate as an RNA virus.
You can't.
You don't have that compartmentalization.
Yeah, but you know, the bacteria guys say that there is a nuclear compartment in bacteria, right?
No, not really.
There's a condensation of the chromosome.
Oh, right? Yeah, that is.
It's not enough.
This is not what the nuclear compartment is about. The nuclear compartment is about separation, physical separation of replication and translation. And that is not something that exists in prokaryotes. Replication, transcription, and translation are all coupled.
Right.
Very much unlike in eukaryotes.
All right, and that's why you think an RNA virus cannot compete. That's an interesting idea,
I think so, that we know for a fact this is not going to change with any further exploration, that they are poor competitors in the prokaryotic world, but very good among eukaryotes.
Okay.
And that's my favorite explanation, but I would not say I'm fully satisfied with it. I would like to become more specific on that.
Have you published anywhere the your thoughts on the different origins or the multiple origins of RNA virus groups? I'm really interested to see how, in your mind, you said there were four founding groups of plus-strand RNA viruses. I'd be interested to see in your mind how you develop that and how those evolve into what we see currently.
Oh, most definitely. That has been published on several occasions in different versions. To begin with, the rather well-known paper in 1993, which is a sort of big review of the evolution and classification of positive strand RNA viruses, and they don't believe these fundamental things have changed. They published more on this, in particular on the evolution of double-stranded RNA viruses, but I think the main division was obtained correctly at the time.
Okay, so I need to educate myself. Yep. I got work to do. Okay.
PubMed.
Good.
There's a thing called PubMed. Let me ask you a couple more things. Is that okay?
Entirely.
I'm really interested in retroelements and why our genome has so many of them. Can you shed some illumination on that?
I think so. First of all, What are retro elements? Retro elements are virus-like element, viruses and virus-like elements that use reverse transcriptase to produce a DNA copy of their RNA genome. And they also encode an integrase that allows them to integrate into multiple sites in the host genome. That's what they are. And they're ubiquitous in the world. They exist in all kinds of cells, very much including prokaryotes. In fact, retroviruses, to the very best of our knowledge, do not exist there, but retroelements very much do. So-called retrons, so-called group 2 cell splicing introns, they all sort of jump around in the prokaryotic world. But they never reach very high copy number. At most, per bacterial genome, you can have 20 or 30 of these. Mm-hmm. So they're kind of lie low. Now, why have they proliferated in that grotesque manner in animal genomes? Well, that takes us outside virology into general theory of population genetics and evolutionary biology. I think because they can, and they can because purifying selection in the small in organisms with very small effective population size, such as large animals, is extremely inefficient, and we basically cannot weed out these viruses that by chance infest our genomes.
So,
of course.
So purifying selection means if a gene gets is removed from the population.
Precisely.
Okay.
This is what it means. In other words, to put it in a more concrete way, that means that a variant devoid of a particular piece of DNA has a measurable advantage over the genome that has it. But the reality of it is such that in these large organisms with small effective population size, the power of drift, of random fixation of any genetic change, simply survival, not survival of the fittest, but survival of the luckiest. The power of that process is such that purifying selection is extremely inefficient. And, of course, this is the main factor, but it also has to be combined with the chance emergence of a highly efficient founder of these different groups of retro elements. Once such a thing appears, it meets relatively little resistance in these complex organisms.
But don't less complex organisms also have retro elements?
They do, but never that many.
I see.
So of course we do, including bacteria and archaea.
Right.
But it's always a few copies in the chromosome. It's a few more in fungi. But this kind of a grotesque situation, as we see in animals and plants, where 80% of the genome, more, may derive from these elements, that we do not see in simpler organisms.
Yeah, I think we mentioned once the fugu, which is a puffer fish,
yes,
has very few.
Relatively few.
Relatively few.
It has a quite a compact genome by vertebrate standards.
Yes.
Well, I'm not so sure about the population genetics of fugu and why it happened that way.
Okay.
Fugu is just too ugly for these things.
Yeah,
right?
I thought that it's ugly for you, but it's
poisonous.
Poisonous for sure.
But these elements have no function in the genome. Is that correct? We don't know.
Not entirely. Not entirely. No, we know a few things, actually. Mm-hmm. Quite a few things. You see, if you have so much of something, even if it's originally junk, mm-hmm, you certainly will make some use of it. And surely animals do, and plants. For instance, the large terminal repeats, long terminal repeats of these elements are good promoters.
Right.
And they're used by many host genes. There's more to the story, though. some of the proteins of these genes, that of these viruses, that actually are fusion proteins that are they. Function in recognizing the cell surface and fusing the virus particle, the virion, with the cell. So it's quite interesting. Such a gene has been recruited by at the base of the evolution of placental mammals as a placental receptor.
Right.
If not for the virus,
we wouldn't have live birth. Yeah.
We wouldn't have live birth. Right. Precisely.
But there's a few. There's just a handful of all of these copies. It's not very much.
Right? No, not very much, but it's all important, nevertheless.
Sure. So the rest of these genes can be in our genomes with no negative consequence.
Many of them are in our genomes without significant, measurable negative consequences. But a small fraction in terms of the proportion of those elements. But quite many, in terms of the absolute number, are recruited for this and that, for promoters and cancers and the like.
Right. Yeah, and it'll turn out that some of them are microRNAs or something.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
Right.
Or even long-term non-coding RNAs.
Right. So the sense I'm getting is that the viruses that make us sick are insignificant in numbers compared to everything else, all the other viruses that are out there.
That's absolutely true, because the heavy bulk of viruses in the biosphere are viruses of prokaryotes, of bacteria in particular. I don't have the exact numbers, but I think more than 90% of the physical mass of viruses are bacteriophages.
But even of the eukaryotic viruses...
Even among eukaryotes, that is also true. The viruses that make us sick, or even, economically important plants sick, they're a small fraction.
What's amazing is that the whole field of virology started from viruses that make plants and people sick. That was the original impetus, right?
Sure.
Although very soon this was followed by identification of viruses that make bacteria sick.
Right, phages, right. But human virology was dominated until very recently, I would argue, just simply on studying viruses that cause human illness, right?
Well, I think to a degree this is true as of today.
And that's why we're at the National Institutes
of Health, right?
Yes, that is absolutely correct. And looking at this situation realistically, in genomics, both computational and now experimental, that has become so much cheaper and easier. We can deal with all kinds of viruses experimentally.
Sure. Not so much.
The opportunities do not so much exist for those that are either disease agents in humans and economically important animals and plants, or their safe relatives.
I don't think we're going to get very far in understanding what the dark matter does, unfortunately. I think we can describe it, but studying it is going to be really difficult. I wanted to just mention a few things that I got from this Virocentric Perspective article, which are little sound bites, which are great. The majority of distinct genes reside in viruses. Isn't that amazing? I think most people would not know this.
It's however, plain fact by now, not a conjecture.
Viruses have the most diverse gene pool. Not a single gene is shared by all viruses.
Totally true.
But there's some things that are similar among different viruses, and all in common have something similar, a polymerase motif, or not even, right?
Large part. The virus world is really big. And large part share what I like to call the hallmark genes.
Right.
It's good to represent many things in the world, and in particular the diversity of viruses in the form of a network where different parts are linked to each other through different shared elements. In this way, you can pretty much make a represent the world of viruses as a fully connected graph. But that does not mean that there is a direct connection between the majority of points. There isn't.
Right, and you have a couple of those graphs in these papers.
Yes, indeed. I think that's the right way to represent the evolutionary relationship.
So if there were life on another planet, would there be selfish virus-like elements and viruses there as well?
It's absolutely inevitable.
That's this quote that you picked out. Cheaters inevitably involved when there's a chance to cheat.
That's great. That's what you wrote, you know?
Yes, and and they stand by it.
Oh, of course. I think it's great.
In all walks of life.
In all walks of life, even in artificial life,
right.
Even in evolution that occurs entirely within the computer, we all know, somewhat unfortunately, all too well, what are computer viruses.
Right.
So should cheater not have a bad connotation? Is that what you're saying?
No.
I don't like to be thought of as an organism of cheaters, but we are.
Certainly, it's impossible not to assign some bad connotation to cheaters. But it has to be realized that because all life evolves as an interactive, all life is coevolution of cheaters and cooperators. There are many situations where the existence of cheaters actually makes the population of cooperators more stable.
Hmm.
So they are bad, but they are not entirely bad. Using an anthropomorphic analogy, living in a bad part of a city is, of course, dangerous and in many respects unpleasant, but it also makes you better prepared to all eventualities.
Keep you on your toes.
Indeed.
So, Eugene, do you think that altruism is a evolutionarily favorable trait? Selectable, maybe?
Yes, it is.
It is? And we know this. There's evidence.
Most definitely is. There is some debate on that issue still among evolutionary biologists, but I think it's a mood debate.
Yeah?
It's definitely an evolvable trait. Moreover, a trait that has evolved in all kinds of life forms, in particular in all cellular life forms, starting with the first cells, with bacteria.
Okay. Well, that's good.
That's a happy thought, yeah.
Because
we
talk about that now,
right? Right. I like that.
Eugene, we had a wide-ranging conversation. Is there something that we missed that we should tell people?
We covered many, many points, and that is fantastic. I would just tell people very clearly that beyond any doubt by now, viruses are the most common biological entities on the planet physically. The greatest number of any distinct biological entities, particles on the planet, are virus particles. And they are also, again beyond any doubt, the greatest reservoir of genetic diversity. I think if people are left with these two notions, I was about to say ideas, but they are not ideas. They are observations by now. I'm happy with that.
Very good. Well, I think we have taken enough of
well,
Eugene's
yeah,
time,
and this is just too elegant. We shouldn't. We should just leave it.
We'll leave
this.
It at this.
This.
So yeah. I'll wrap this up.
This
wonderful episode of TWiV will be found at twiv.tv and also on iTunes. And if you like what we do, as we always say, go over to iTunes and rate the show, leave a comment or two, and that helps to keep us visible on that very crowded iTunes directory. It's been our pleasure to talk today with Eugene Koonin, who is a senior investigator at the National Center for Biotechnology Information. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Vincent. Thank you so much, Rich.
Sure.
It's a great initiative, and it's wonderful talking
it's
to you.
It's good fun.
Rich Condit is normally at the University of Florida, Gainesville. Thank you, Rich, for coming over to
Quite
do this.
Welcome. This is a thrill. This is really a great, this is a good time. Great
it's,
time.
It's a lot of fun. I tell you, I enjoy these TWiVs, every yeah. one of them so much, and I like when we get to get deep with people yeah. like this. So yeah. as long as you're here in D.C., we should do this
Absolutely.
More
There's going to be four more times.
Great. I'm Vincent Racaniello, and you can find me at virology.ws. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWiV is viral.